Minister.
Humphrey, do you see it as part of your job to help ministers make fools of themselves?
Well, I've never met one that needed any help.
Yes, Minister, and its sequel, Yes, Prime Minister, poked the finger of fun at government. Over five series, it charted the rise to power of the nation's most unlikely Prime Minister, the Right Honourable Jim Hacker.
I've been Prime Minister for, oh, let me see, 3 days now.
And a very good PM you are, too, if I may say so.
I'm not fishing for compliments, though it has been going rather well, hasn't
it? Oh, indeed.
British politics took a surprise turn when Hacker was appointed to number 10. Despite well-founded doubts about his abilities, Hacker saw himself as a popular man of the people.
Hacker was a journalist, and before that, a lecturer at LSE. So he'd never run anything at all.
After the landslide election victory of 1980, Hacker had been made the Minister for Administrative Affairs. His bulging portfolio included quangos, fallout shelters, badger colonies, and the Euro sausage.
Do you want to eat salami for breakfast with your egg and bacon? I don't. And I won't.
His relationship with the media was never easy and gave him many awkward moments.
You know, I'm glad you asked me that question.
Jim was desperate not to let himself down in front of the cameras or in the presence of journalists.
During his career, Hacker's main political relationships were with civil servants. Bernard Woolley, the very model of professional impartiality.
I'm both sides of centre, with slight leanings to the right and the left.
And Sir Humphrey Appleby, who fixed it for Jim as both minister and prime minister.
Ministers and their civil servants so often cover up and defend where they should seek out and destroy.
If Hacker was an unlikely PM, Yes Minister pulled off an even bigger trick, turning the stuffed suits of Whitehall into comedy heroes.
And what about ministers?
Well, ministers, of course, have a whole range of dazzling qualities, including...
But viewers might never have been given this glimpse down the corridors of power if writer Anthony Jay had got the job he'd set his heart on.
I
wasn't actually really that interested in politics when I started. I was really interested in sport, and I joined the outside broadcast department to start with, hoping to be a great cricket commentator.
Cricket commentaries were out, but current affairs were in, and Jay joined the BBC's Tonight programme, which took a healthily irreverent view of the state of the nation. Then Jay moved on to satirising politics in That Was the Week That Was, where he struck up a friendship with David Frost.
Well, we had this idea together for the Frost Report, which was comedy sketches about aspects of British life, like holidays and leisure and politics. One of the people he recruited was John Cleese, and I got to know John, and we got on fine.
Let him who is without sin cast the first stone.
Sensing the commercial potential of comedy, Jay and Cleese went into business together, calling their company Video Arts and specialising in funny training films.
Who sold you this, then?
Cleese and Jay wrote the scripts, but they also needed other actors. John Cleese called on his old friend, Jonathan Lynn.
What's actually gone wrong?
I was very sympathetic. Poor old John, he's committed himself to this mad idea. And I'll do what I can to help out.
First time I met Johnny was when he acted in our very first film, which was How Service Engineers Managed to Lose Business While They're Repairing Equipment.
You've been using this, haven't you?
All training films had been really boring hitherto because they showed people how to do a job right. And Tony realised that the way to make them entertaining was to show how to do it wrong.
Like Cleese, Jonathan Lynn was a graduate of Cambridge University's Footlights Club, and they appeared on Broadway together in the comedy revue Cambridge Circus. Back in Britain, Lynn appeared on stage in Fiddler on the Roof and played small parts in TV sitcoms like The Liverbirds. But it wasn't until some Cambridge friends, now goodies, started writing for another sitcom that Lynn's career really took off.
Bill Oddie and Graham Garden wrote a part in Doctor in the House called Danny Hooley in the second series of Doctor in the House, and I think they wrote it with me in mind.
I never did trust you, Upton. You're shifty. Everybody says so.
Do they?
Well, I do.
1 week, somebody didn't deliver a script in time. And George Layton, who I'd become friends with, said, why don't we have a go at writing an episode?
It's me, Paul Collier!
So we did, and we had beginner's luck. And after that, such is the dearth of people who can deliver a funny half hour, we were sort of swamped with offers.
Dozens of scripts for the Doctor series and On the Buses established Lynn as a comedy writer. So when Cleese went off to write Fawlty Towers, Lynn was invited to take over scripting duties at Video Arts.
We started writing comedy training films together and we got on fine. It was a very happy, successful partnership.
Impressed with Johnny's talent, Tony Jay thought he'd sound him out about a different type of comedy.
Tony said to me, I've thought of doing a situation comedy about the corridors of power, about what happens in government, about the civil service.
When I first mentioned the Yes Minister idea to Johnny, he was sort of coolish about it.
I thought that was really the most boring suggestion that had come my way for a long time. So I said, no thanks.
Lynn might have blocked the start of Hacker's career, but Tony wasn't discouraged, suspecting politics could be a comedy goldmine for someone prepared to dig.
I think I first got the idea for Yes Minister working with politicians and seeing how actually the whole thing that people saw on the screen was about a quarter of the real story, and that all the work of government was done behind the scenes by press officers and private secretaries and permanent secretaries and the people who all knew how it worked. And then I thought, do you know, this is exactly the same as Steptoe and Son. You've got young Steptoe, you've got these wonderful, oh, Dad, we could do the most wonderful thing, you know. Well, he could do it, and with all the aspirations, and his father, who really knows the bit, is saying, nah, I can't do that.
Having spent 2 years directing plays, Johnny Lynn was now ready to write again.
And Tony said, do you remember that idea? And he said, yes. And I said, are you interested now? And I said, well, I don't know, I might be. He said, well, let's meet and talk about it. So we did. And we thought, well, we'll research it and see if we can work out how to do this show.
Was there anything funny about Whitehall? Plenty. Marcia Williams, Harold Wilson's former private secretary, and Bernard Donoghue, head of Number 10's political unit, were prepared to speak off the record.
We never mentioned each to the other because they disliked each other quite a lot.
We normally, but not always, met for a nice fish lunch. But we would discuss then at a meeting thoughts and ideas.
We've read everything you could read, but what we were really about was the things you wouldn't read and people wouldn't write, but would tell us over lunch.
I had never revealed that I helped Yes Minister. Nobody knew. For me, it was a kind of secret, private pleasure.
The indiscretions over lunch convinced Lynn that there was a rich source of comedy at the heart of government. The show and the characters were taking shape.
We discovered we were able to nail it down to actually three characters who would enable us to preserve the dramatic truth of the situation.
To bring the first script to life, one character needed to embody the whole civil service ethos.
Sir Humphrey was, in my view, a creation of absolute genius, personifying the aspects of behaviour at the top in Whitehall.
I thought of someone who'd been terribly good in a video arts training film. That was Nigel Hawthorne.
Nigel Hawthorne was a respected stage actor who had recently won plaudits for his appearance in Privates on Parade. His ability to play both dominance and deference made him perfect for Sir Humphrey Appleby, the department's permanent secretary.
He sees himself as a defender of the nation's interests against these people who come and go and never see anything through because they're never in the same job for more than about 18 months anyway.
In spite of Sir Humphrey, the post of minister had to be filled. BBC's head of comedy, John Howard Davis, had chosen his candidate and wouldn't take no for an answer.
I never thought of anybody else but Paul to play the minister. Uniquely, he was absolutely perfect for it. And I hadn't got a second choice.
Paul Eddington had appeared in TV's Adventures of Robin Hood and Catweasel before becoming a favourite as the long-suffering neighbour Jerry in The Good Life.
You've torn my Financial Times.
I am very, very sorry. I do realise that's the eighth deadly sin, but my fruit is suffering.
Well, give it an aspirin.
By 1978, the job of Jim Hacker was his for the taking.
I think we'd always seen the relationship between Jim and Humphrey as being the heart of the comedy, and I think nearly all the really funny scenes are when the two of them are together, but you had to have scenes of them apart because you had to tell the audience what Jim was planning that he didn't want Humphrey to know, or Humphrey was planning he didn't want Jim to know. And so that was where Bernard came in. He was the pig in the middle. He was confided in by both of them, trying to be loyal to both of them, and it made his part a very funny one, a great satisfactory one to write. Yes,
hello. The future Bernard, however, wasn't hello. Waiting for the phone to ring.
Hello! Hello. This is the Fulton Brush Detective Agency at your service. The Foreign Office? Certainly, Mr. Minister. Yes, Mr. Minister. We'll expect you in half an hour then, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you. Goodbye.
I'd seen Derek on television with my kid. We were watching him as with Basil Brush. And I suddenly thought this might be the man for Bernard Woolley.
Basil and I really gelled together. We did 8 series and 2 Royal Command performances. And when I left, because I had to go and act, I really missed him. He became my best friend.
After spending the early 70s hanging out with Basil and popping up in shows like The Liverbirds, Derek Folds was ready to take the civil service challenge. All the elements seemed to be in place for a successful political sitcom.
We only went to pilot, we didn't get a series guaranteed on it, but we wrote a decent treatment and we showed where the fun was and we showed who the characters were and the sort of stories that you could write and the sort of situations that would develop, and really that was enough.
But unfortunately, when I presented it to Paul Eddington for him to play the minister, he turned it down, he didn't like it. He said it never works, not very funny, politics are not funny, they're horrible people.
You really are a pain in the arse, aren't you?
I'm a bully, so I eventually managed to persuade him to do the pilot.
With Paul Eddington on board, however unwillingly, the rest of the team were recruited, including Diana Hoddinott as Jim's sceptical but supportive wife Annie, John Nettleton as the all-powerful Cabinet Secretary Sir Arnold, and Anthony Carrick as Hacker's press officer. Everyone was anxious that the pilot would leave a good impression.
A pilot is always done under extreme nervous tension. No two ways about it, you're frightened to death.
I met Paul, he was wonderful, and Nigel, and we said hello, and we started. And I got these little glasses, and I put them on, and I started to talk a bit like that, you know. Hello. And Paul and I were in the taxi, rehearsing, and he said, why are you talking funny? I said, what do you mean? He's Bernard's, this PPS. I thought I'd do something rather like that. He says, why? And he said, what have you got those glasses on for? I said, it's all character stuff. He said, for God, he said, take the glasses off. Just be you. I said, I don't know how to do that. He said, just be you.
I suppose in the first episode, the characters weren't so well defined. So, in the first episode, there was a scene where I was looking for cigarettes on the floor with my bottom up in the air, in a very non-yes minister, as it turned out to be, way.
You're very tense.
No, I'm not tense. I'm just a politician's wife. I'm not allowed to have feelings. A happy, carefree politician's wife.
The cast were nervous, and even the director was having doubts.
I said, with a courage that I didn't actually feel, but I said, if we do it exactly as it's written, they will laugh a lot. It is really funny. And he said, well, it's very clever, but, we've got to put in some laughs. So he wanted to put in laughs that were not on subject.
Could Whitehall's political shenanigans really whet the public's appetite?
It's going to happen.
The Prime Minister giveth and the Prime Minister taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Prime Minister.
The audience got it immediately. A huge laugh. And we knew that we'd sort of hit on something.
Yes, they got it exactly. They know precisely what it's about.
They were so sick of politicians. They were so sick of the hypocrisy and the lying and the evasion.
Huge sort of cloud of worry just blew away.
I knew as soon as I saw the recording of the pilot that it was going to be a success. And it was commissioned almost immediately on my recommendation from the controllers.
John Howard Davis's confidence in the show brought with it new music, new titles drawn by Gerald Scarfe, and a new director, comedy stalwart Sidney Lotterby. Was Britain ready for Yes Minister? In 1978, the public were disillusioned with politics and politicians.
So after the Prime Minister postponed the election and saw the TUC reject his pay policy, the government now looks set on industrial confrontation it didn't want.
Rising inflation and a series of strikes in the so-called winter of discontent would paralyse the country. Jim Callaghan's Labour government was on the rocks and a decisive general election was around the corner. The country was divided, and so were the writers.
Tony is, I would describe as right-wing, and I would describe myself as not right-wing.
But in fact, that didn't make any difference because neither of us was trying to put over any propaganda. I mean, we weren't trying to improve society, we weren't trying to put forward political doctrines. We were just, you know, we were not a social meliorist programme. We were merely saying, you know, this is what goes on and isn't it funny?
But the politicians weren't quite ready to be laughed at.
The BBC said, we like this, we're going to do a series, but we've got to wait till after the next election because we can't put it on immediately prior to an election.
Can't have that, you know, might deal with an issue that was a hot party potato.
You know, everyone thought Callaghan would have the sense to have an election before the economy imploded, but he didn't. So he finally had an election when he had no choice, and Thatcher came to power, and right after that, the BBC started running the show.
So, in February 1980, Yes Minister was on air, and the audience didn't take long to tune in. At the root of the comedy were Whitehall machinations and elegant skullduggery.
Will you answer a direct question?
I strongly advise you not to ask a direct question.
Why?
It might provoke a direct answer.
Never has yet.
The public caught on to Nigel Sir Humphrey. I think he suddenly became a favourite comic figure with the general public, this Machiavellian, devious comic ogre that Nigel created.
I have something to say to you which you may not like to hear.
Why should today be any different?
Every week he had one enormously long speech in each episode.
The traditional allocation of executive responsibilities has always been so determined as to liberate the ministerial incumbent from the administrative minutiae.
Late on in Yes, Prime Minister, he told me he still remembered every single one of them. I felt terribly guilty cluttering up a decent mind with all that complete guff.
By devolving the managerial functions to those whose experience and qualifications have better formed them for the performance of such humble offices.
What he did with some of those speeches is... I was open-mouthed every week.
Thereby releasing their political overlords for the more onerous duties and profound deliberations which are the inevitable concomitant of their exalted position.
Now, whatever made you think I wouldn't want to hear that?
Well, I thought it might upset you.
How could it? I didn't understand a single word.
They used to sometimes, you know, do a scene running 10 minutes. And I was at the end of the table. And I'm watching them. It's like tennis. And I thought... And I had the last line, which was a big laugh. And they let me keep it in.
Nothing wrong with subsidising sport. Sport is educational.
We have sex education too. Should we subsidise sex, perhaps?
Oh, could we?
One of Yes Minister's most memorable plots was provided by the true story of a diplomatic mission.
I went to Pakistan with Prime Minister Callaghan and we had a quite hilarious experience which I conveyed.
We were meticulous about making sure that anything we wrote either had happened or could happen.
We were faced by the prospect of an evening dinner in Pakistan with the President.
5 hours of orange juice.
5 hours? Without a single drinky? Why did you let me come on this trip, Humphrey?
We were rather worried about this, and we came up with a solution.
Why don't we set up a security communications room next door to the reception? You know, emergency telephones, telex lines to Downing Street, all that sort of thing. Then we could fill it with cases of booze brought in from the embassy.
Minister, liven up the orange juice. That is a stroke of genius.
During the banquet beforehand, we all had our glasses of orange juice, and periodically we would say, Oh, I must get in touch with number 10.
Messages in the communication?
Well, there is one for Sir Humphrey, Minister.
Oh, good, yes.
Yes, the Soviet embassy's on the line, Sir Humphrey, and Mr. Smirnoff.
I had a line, which I could never say. And Paul said, you're going to do this on the take? I said, no, I will get it. I will. I won't laugh. And there's just a slight...
Lawrence of Arabia. Wanted in the communications room.
Who is it?
Napoleon.
Over three series of Yes Minister, Jay and Lynn drew on the inside information from their special advisers to create situations that were all too believable.
Excuse me, Minister. BBC.
The characters were recognisable to everyone, except for the real-life Humphreys and Hackers.
Politicians would say, I think you've got the civil service absolutely to a T. I mean, you haven't, you know, politicians aren't like you're showing them, but the civil servants are just absolutely like that. And the civil servants say, you have got politicians off perfectly. I mean, you know, the civil servants aren't like that, but you know, the politicians, that's absolutely right. And, of course, the reason is that we wrote politicians as civil servants see them and civil servants as politicians see them.
In fact, Yes Minister is a series of training films for politicians. It's how not to run the government. If they would only view it in that light, we might generally be all better off.
They say there's nothing new in politics, and after three series, the writers decided Hacker's career had run its course.
Yes, I suppose we have got rather fond of one another, in a way.
In a way, yes.
Like a terrorist and his hostage.
Which one of you is the terrorist?
Oh, he is.
We were going to be repeating ourselves. If I didn't have anything more to say, I wanted to stop. Tony felt the same way.
The BBC sort of accepted this, but they, you know, people kept saying, couldn't you do another series? And we said, well, no, not really.
The final series of Yes Minister was broadcast in 1982, and Jonathan Lynn and Tony Jay went their separate ways. But the show continued to win awards, including a third BAFTA. Much to their surprise, the writers found their characters had become favourites inside the establishment. It was a decidedly mixed blessing.
One of the BBC's most popular comedy series won an award today from Mrs. Mary Whitehouse and the National Viewers and Listeners Association. The series is Yes Minister, about the conflicts between politicians and their civil servants. The award was presented by the programme's biggest fan.
3 days beforehand, Paul and Nigel got a message saying Mrs. Thatcher had written a script, a sketch, and wanted to act with them at this presentation, and they were horrified.
I was delighted. I mean, I thought, this is marvellous, you know, to actually get the accolade of the Prime Minister being keen enough on the programme to show the world that she would like to be in it. Paul and Nigel were definitely not Thatcherites, and they didn't really want to do it. But on the other hand, they didn't want to say they didn't want to do it.
I want you to abolish economists.
Abolish economists, Prime Minister?
Yes, abolish economists, and quickly.
All of them, Brandon.
As far as I was concerned, it kind of put the crown on the programme as far as public political acceptance was concerned.
It's so dreadful that finally you can't help laughing.
Sir Humphrey.
Prime Minister.
What did you say your degree was?
Politics and, economics.
Capital, my dear Sir Humphrey. Capital. You'll know exactly where to start.
Yes, Prime Minister.
I'd like to thank Mrs. Whitehouse for this award, and I'd like to thank Mrs. Thatcher for finally taking her rightful place in the world of situation comedy, which got a kind of a gasp from the assembled journalists, and then maybe the biggest laugh I've ever had in my life. So I didn't get invited back to number 10 after that, but I thought it was worth it.
In Jim Hacker, the writers had created a national icon. 2 years after they'd ended Yes Minister, the public still wanted Hacker back. Bill Cotton, the BBC's director of television, begged for more, no matter what the cost. Jay and Lynn finally relented, on the condition that Hacker's career would move in a new direction and they could tackle new subjects.
Defence, foreign policy and other things that were way out of Jim Hacker's area of government. Those were the subjects we hadn't been able to touch.
if the right things happen.
It was very hard to engineer a plot which nobody questioned, where all three of them went from there to there, to number 10.
The writers knew that the civil service would always make the right thing happen.
Gosh.
The more ridiculous the plot, the more it proved their point. So, if Sir Humphrey were in charge of the civil service, he'd want an obedient PM by his side. A series of scandals and a well-timed publicity boost for Jim Hacker ensured the door to number 10 would only open for one man.
We told Paul in the BBC club, I remember, we said, Paul, you're going to be Prime Minister in the next series. And you could see him change before our very eyes. He went sort of...
This is wonderful. I see it all now. A new deal for Britain. Hacker's grand design. From time to time in our great island story, it falls to one man. To lead his people out of the valley of the shadow and into the sunlit uplands of peace and prosperity.
Paul would sometimes say, do I have to say this line? I can just act it with my face. And so the first couple of times it happened, we said, well, show us what you mean. And he did, and it was funny. So after that, there would nearly always be a line or two in the script which would say, Paul needn't say this line if he doesn't. A whole sequence of thoughts could flash across his face, and you knew what they were. He had the most immense skill as a comedy actor.
He would develop and expand the things, the comic things that he had created in the rehearsal, and his timing to an audience was absolutely extraordinary.
Now, look, I realise you have to have loyalty to your colleagues, but you also have a broader loyalty to Cabinet and its policy.
I agree.
You agree?
Yes.
You agree with me?
I agree with you.
Who do you agree with?
With you.
As the series goes along, Hacker gets better at running things and better at dealing with Sir Humphrey.
If you're wanted again at number 10, you'll be sent for.
You mean when?
I mean when. And if.
He became more wily, and just as you thought that he might not have the intellect to cope and deal with anything, he managed to best them.
To help Hacker get the hang of things, the writers hurried back to their mole in Whitehall for more inside information.
Why did you allow Sir Humphrey to come in here when I explicitly told him not to?
Well, I couldn't stop him.
Why not?
He's bigger than me.
Well, he must be confined to the Cabinet Office.
But how?
Lock the communicating door.
He has a key.
Take his key away from him.
Take his key away from him?
Take his key away from him.
You take his key away from him.
We did discover that there is a green baize door between the Cabinet Office and number 10. And that it would be theoretically possible for someone to be locked out.
Open this door!
Open this door!
You'll pay for this! Open the bloody door!
They had the genius of creating what was just an off-the-cuff suggestion into real art.
I must protest in the strongest possible terms. My profound opposition to a newly instituted practice which imposes severe and intolerable restrictions upon the ingress and egress of senior members of the hierarchy and which will, in all probability, should the current deplorable innovation be perpetuated, precipitate a constriction of the channels of communication and culminate in a condition of organizational atrophy and administrative paralysis which will render effectively impossible the coherent and coordinated discharge of the function of government within Her Majesty's United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland.
You mean you've lost your key?
And the best in light entertainment TV performance, the winner is Nigel Hawthorne for Yes, Prime Minister.
The public lapped up the new series and the accolades just kept on coming.
We won the BAFTA, the best programme, we kept winning, which is great. Nigel and Paul were always nominated together for best comedy performance. And it was always Nigel that won and not Paul, and I thought that was just a shame. So did Nigel. He got embarrassed.
And Nigel, I think, really wished Paul had won one or two of them because he didn't need to keep winning, and Paul got more and more disappointed.
Paul had to be this comedy buffoon character and yet a credible, just credible, Minister of the Crown, whereas it was much easier for Nigel. And also Nigel was playing a kind of character that people knew nothing about.
It's the part that wins awards, everyone knows that. That's why the same people keep winning them all the time. Every year in the theatre, on television, movies. You know, you can't win a prize if you haven't got the prize-winning part.
Two of Britain's favourite public figures have received awards in the Queen's New Year's Honours List, but you won't find their names in the usual guides to politicians and civil servants. They're actors Paul Eddington and Nigel Hawthorne.
They said, "We just get your reaction to the news." I said, "What news?" They said, "Well, your co-stars have been awarded the CBE." And I said, "What for?" And that was headline. Bernard says, "What for?" Could have added, "Where's mine?"
The comedy was interrupted by harsh reality when Paul Eddington was diagnosed with skin cancer.
Paul was beginning to show signs of his illness, and we were worried whether or not he could really stand up to the strain of another series.
I know exactly who reads the papers. The Daily Mirror is read by people who think they run the country. The Guardian is read by people who think they ought to run the country.
People don't really notice this, but he is mostly behind his desk.
The Times is read by the people who actually do run the country. The Daily Mail is read by the wives of the people who run the country.
We minimised the amount Hacker had to move, and he minimised it, and he remained just as funny.
The Morning Star is read by people who think the country ought to be run by another country. And the Daily Telegraph is read by people who think it is.
I'm Prime Minister, what about the people who read The Sun?
Sun readers don't care who runs the country as long as she's got big tits.
The pressure was growing on us because the show had become such a kind of institution by this time, and people expected it to be sensationally funny and interesting every week.
We'd done all the things that were really fun, and it wasn't. It would start to be a bit repetitive.
We thought, we'll quit while we're ahead.
In 1988, after two series, Yes, Prime Minister ended. But by now, Sir Humphrey, Bernard and Jim Hacker were seen as unofficial ambassadors for the British government. Paul, in particular, found it hard to shed Hacker's image.
Paul went to Australia, for example. I mean, he was greeted like a Prime Minister rather than like an actor. You know, and he'd be treated as if he was the Prime Minister or the Minister. He thought that was terribly funny.
I wanted Paul to stand for Parliament. I wanted him to change his name by default to Jim Hacker and enter an election. He would have won. He would have. And I said, if you become an MP, I promise to write all your speeches. And we can have tremendous amount of fun. And he said, but this would, Paul was kind of responsible person. He said, that would bring the whole edifice tumbling down in ruins. And I said, well, yes, it might. That... He said, no, I can't do that.
Paul Eddington carried on acting, and his last major part in The Chamomile Lawn reunited him with his Good Life co-star Felicity Kendall. He died of cancer in 1995. Nigel Hawthorne built on the success of Yes, Prime Minister, winning awards for the title role in The Madness of King George. In 1999, Sir Humphrey became Sir Nigel. Anthony Jay also received a knighthood for services rendered.
Tony got his knighthood for something that I was very eager for him to keep under wraps, and it did more or less stay under wraps till after the show. He wrote party political broadcast for Mrs. Thatcher.
That went on right through the Yes Minister years, so they were more and more cagey, the civil servants, thinking I'm going to make fun of them, whatever they say. But they took it very well and were very helpful. And of course it did. I mean, it obviously helped my understanding of how things happen in politics.
He really got it for political services to the Conservative Party, something that I could never have got and would never have wanted.
Sir Anthony Jay continued writing political speeches and books and making films for Video Arts. Jonathan Lynn's future lay in America, directing hit movies such as My Cousin Vinny and The Whole Nine Yards.
I've made one or two very good films, and one or two that are less good. due to the pressures of the Hollywood system, which it took me a while to understand. But I'm still at it. And I'm still having a good time.
As for the long-suffering Bernard, according to the Hacker Diaries, he rises to become head of the civil service, bringing with it the inevitable knighthood.
Sir Bernard Woolley. So in the end, I did get my K.
Derek Folds left Westminster far behind to appear in over 300 episodes of the ITV series Heartbeat.
Mr. Blaketon.
Yeah, very observant, David.
So Jim Hacker entered the political hall of fame and Sir Humphrey became synonymous with the civil service. From an uncertain start, Yes Minister went on to win more BAFTAs than any other British comedy series. Since then, politicians have come and gone, but the trials of Hacker, Humphrey and Bernard remain as relevant as ever.
Civil servants still wear the same suits. Politicians are still just as devious. Spin is just as common. So I think it stands up very well.
Is it the truth?
The truth and nothing but the truth.
The whole truth?
Of course not.
Very little has changed in Westminster. I've just finished Alastair Campbell's diaries, and it seems to me that life goes on very much the same way as it was portrayed in the series.
We've no real power. We're just a sort of American missile base, that's all.
I enjoy the fact that we got it right. We managed to be both funny and informative.
I have a problem, and I need your help.
Oh, dear, oh, dear, oh, dear. Can't you run the country on your own?
It's one of the loveliest sounds to a comedy writer's ear is the sound of people laughing at his gags.
I think he wants to govern Britain.
Well, stop him, Bernard.
Great script.